connections also, as you rightly say, are worse than they were 10 years ago. So despite that, we do still have people who want to be police officers. We are choosing the right ones. We have some really good quality people coming in, both as new recruits and transferees, and we'll continue to do that. That won't be the case for other forces around the country. Down south, it is harder to recruit for numerous reasons, standard of living reasons, etc., etc. That may be an opportunity for ourselves, because if they can't take their recruitment numbers, then I will certainly take the cash and take the recruitments at the same time and increase on a quicker basis with government funds coming in to do so. So it does give us some opportunities, but in the short term, I'm happy we'll be able to recruit the right quality despite the numbers that we're bringing in.
I'm grateful for that, Chief. I think it is probably wise to accelerate the recruitment while, you know, because once the forces get up to speed and try to recruit from the same pool, there is no next question first or best dressed. So I think it's a wise decision. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. Commissioner, I have Councillor Sweeney.
Just on the comment that you made, Commissioner, about obviously the people that you have spoken to, it is a tiny percentage of the whole area of Merseyside, and as you say, as these are non-political forums, but it would be remiss of me as both of a representative and a resident of St. Helens to not, this is not, I know that it's not within your gift from an operational perspective to make these decisions, but I would disagree that the people of St. Helens are happy to be paying more for less. And with centralised police system, again, which is a government's, I think, that I make no bones about the fact that I've raised it time and time again, that we have a lesser service than we ever have. We, at our farthest point, are 16 to 18 miles away from some of the centralised policing model. As representatives, it's something we get challenged on a daily basis about the lack of policing within our area. So in terms of people are prepared to pay more getting less, I would disagree with that comment. I would also say that we have always been a firm supporter of the police. We recognise as representatives the difficulties the police are facing, as we ourselves are facing. However, when the public see that what they will see is that the police are going to be given an extra amount of money, we're going to get more policing on our streets, that may cost us a little bit more, but we would want to see some of them resources on our streets, which is one of your priorities, about having a visible presence within areas. That are you confident with this up, with this precept increase, that each area will see that priority met?
Thank you. I know I flipped my lines in the opening statement I made, but people of Merseyside are not being asked to pay more for less.
Not this year.
Previous years, yeah, that has been the case, but this year, they are being asked to pay what is about 19p a week more for a banding property, and they will be getting more. As I've said, I've consulted on an extra 200 officers. In fact, by March, the end of March next year, there will be 500 more police officers in training than we have currently on the books. So there will be a very significant increase. We could always, and we will argue for more. There is a very strong case for the police forces that carry the greatest burden and the greatest risk in the areas that they manage, like Merseyside, ought to be the ones most protected by the government. And that isn't the case. There's some evidence that forces like Surrey are getting, is it something like 170 more officers? When in fact, over the period of austerity, they've lost about 8 officer posts. So that is an unfair reflection of the burden that the urban and metropolitan police forces carry. But nonetheless, 500 more police officers in Merseyside than we have now is going to be very welcome by the public. Now, I hear what you say about visibility. The Chief can address some of the detail of what you're asking in terms of, can we be sure that every area will feel the benefit? Hand on heart, absolutely. Absolutely you can. If we had those extra 500 police officers, I think we would have been able much more easily to deal with and perhaps sooner, to move to the different kinds of working that we're experimenting with through the violence reduction model and other areas of work that the police are developing with their partners. The one anxiety that I would have going forward would be an increase in police officer and staff numbers that we're now able to celebrate is not being matched by youth workers, youth offending services, and other services that the education, the health service is not being matched in those areas that the police absolutely need to have well-resourced partners to be able to do the job of building safe communities right across the area. So that's the only disappointment for me in this settlement. Chief?
Thanks, Councillor. Yeah. I can understand your frustration. To me, my frustration as well with having 1,100 officers less over that period of time. To reassure you from the start, yes, each police in area will see more local police officers. So there will be more community officers, more neighbourhood officers in each of the police in areas. Also, I've publicly committed to, and will continue to do so, that our more far-flung parts of the force area, Huyton, for instance, will continue to have an inquiry office for as long as I'm Chief Constable. And I spoke about this with Conor McGinn last week, just to reiterate the point again. We intend to keep presence throughout. We intend to increase local policing. We are increasing our schools officers, and that will be right across all regions of the force as well, because I want to get back into having that strong presence within our schools. There are more stop searches happening on the streets of St. Helens than there have been for years and years and years. There's a greater visible police presence in St. Helens than there has been for years. That's more effective, and we're seeing crime reducing as a result. We're seeing detections, outcomes going higher as a result. So the issue that people have about having the response hubs further away, we will continue to have those satellites throughout the force. And we will continue to make sure that we have as good a response as possible in the circumstances to every part of the force area. But no part of the force area will be left behind. No part will be abandoned. And we'll maintain that visibility. I'm particularly keen to do so in the more far-flung parts of the force. One, politically, just to make sure people realise it's not all about Liverpool. And I know that's sometimes the concern. It isn't. Our highest risk might be Liverpool and Knowsley, but, and Sefton, but despite that, the rest of the parts of the Merseyside area need to have that reassurance and that confidence that policing is there. So it will remain, it's not going to change, and there will be more officers, an increase in officers in each part of the force area.
Well, I'd just like to pick up, if I may, on the philosophical point. I spent a period of time on the former police authority, roughly the same period when Bernard Hogan Hell was the chief at that time. And certainly I was about as strongly opposed to the new system that we now have as you could possibly be. I felt that the old system had the great advantage of being better spread, more democratic, and the new system that was I took a political view that it was a step backwards. But I'm very glad that we have the commission that we do have, because of course I've known Jayne from previous life as well.
I
come here representing, I think, certainly the ward I represent in the world is one of the areas of greatest financial hardship in Northern Europe. And I do take the point about how people in the lower end of the sort of financial income strain will be disadvantaged by it. But my regular contact with people is in the several social clubs I attend, and every supermarket I ever go into, because you automatically get surrounded by people who have to be telling you what's wrong. I sense that people will be willing to pay this reluctantly because they know that the alternatives are abysmal. And I'll just end on a philosophical note as well, because how often do we hear the term, we are where we are? Well, the government are in that position. The period from before the present incumbent in the Prime Minister Wirral created the conditions which made if I can express this in the way that it's closest to me, our PCSOs were the eyes and ears who knew far more about what was happening than just about anybody else. The loss of those and the loss of the policing, when you can actually see two bodies walking along together in the rougher areas, if you see two bodies together now, the locals say, good God, who are they? Are they lost? Because there aren't enough of them. And it takes me back to a philosophical point in a sense. I'm rather reminded of the origin of the term. We are where we are. It really comes from the Sophocles play about Oedipus, where Antigone said, not where we are, where we are, they are where they are. I'm afraid the government, I say they are where they are, and they're now trying to get out of a hole that they've dug. They created the conditions in which we, without the staff at the frontline offices we need, and they're now trying to pour a little bit of soil back in the hole they dug.
Very, very interested in all the views that have been put forward. I represent and live in an area of multiple deprivation, we are forming a high crime area with my orange green. So we're aware of the problems that have been that we've experienced because of the funding cuts to the place. Now, if there's things that my residents are really concerned about, it's the bins, it's the libraries, and it's policing. And I often, people phone me if they've got antisocial behaviour in their area, and I say, well, look, it's all right ringing me, but have you rung? No, it's not. What we're ringing the police for, have you? Now, they are greatly concerned about what's happened, and although you're not putting back the entire number of police officers that we've lost over the past 2 years, it's a move in the right direction, and I welcome that. And people don't like paying more, nobody likes paying more, but they do understand the correlation between paying more and getting a better service for what they've got. I realise that might not have happened in the past, but I think this is definitely a move in the right direction, and I look forward to when we can get some more things on the street. And can I just say, before I finish, one of the things that we greatly miss since the past 5-10 years is the presence of policemen, our local policemen, at our residence groups. That doesn't happen anymore. And you know what? I think that was very key in keeping local crime down, that people knew and understood who the local sergeants, who the police were, who the community workers were. And that's, if we ever get anybody, can we please get some of that back into our community so that they can recognise and identify the police of care within our community.
Thank you very much.
And
I'll take Council Rowlands as the last in this block.
Thanks, Chair. Just to remind everybody to use their mics because the people at the back are hard of hearing. I don't want to get into the philosophical side of it and so forth on the incumbent government because quite frankly, yeah, we are where we are. And of course, it's a new government. We're waiting to see. I do welcome what they've done. I do welcome the initiative that the Commissioner's taken and the Chief Contour of actually accelerating that increase in police, because I do feel that that is the right decision to make. I do believe the Commissioner is a vital role here on Merseyside and in the areas that they've been placed, because some accountability has to be be sought, and to make sure, if we want more control within our communities of policing and social services, everything else, we need more accountability and to make sure that is oversight is there. So I do welcome you, Commissioner, and I think it was the right decision to do it over that particular time. I have a little bit of worry about the advancement on the whilst I agree with it, I'm worried about whether after 2021, the funding may be messed about with because you've achieved it earlier, and whether we may lose out on that. That's the only worry I've got, but I really want to thank you for the performance of the force. I think it's excellent and it's been recognised, and I understand your reasoning for pushing those extra police forward faster, because we do want to keep that reputation.
A response to all three, because all three really were comments on the position that we are currently in. I won't get into, you know, austerity actually began in 2008, but we had a plan then. You know, we were going to fend it. Let's not go there. And just to say to you, in immediate terms, the reason why Merseyside Police is able to accelerate the programme, when some forces are saying, we're not in a position to do this yet, that's one of the reasons why so much of the funding is unring-fenced, although there is an expectation that you will meet your target. Because some forces are having to take time to build back in some of the training facilities and training teams that they have taken away through austerity. I think that's fair. We began the process of reinvesting in Merseyside, police did, of investing in the training function about maybe 2 years ago, when we saw that we needed to, because it had been reduced too low, and even to maintain annual recruitment levels, we needed to provide better facilities. And at that time, we had been negotiating to buy Parkland School, which was the project that was going to be the new training base for Merseyside Police. When that didn't transpire, we began the investment in Mather Avenue, and that will be open next month by the Chief and I as the new refurbished, second time it's been refurbished, training centre for Merseyside Police, keeping Lee Green going as well. So we were ready and able to do what other forces weren't in a position to do. So I'm really pleased that, I mean, after last year, I said to the Chief and his Chief Officer group, if I'm going to ask the public to pay more, we have to be really clear that they're getting something for the increase in the precept, which is why we filled vacancies, and why we plan new teams, and we built in an increase in the police officer numbers. So we were starting it last year, and this year we've been able to really, the door was opened and we've ran through it and said we're going to make the most of this opportunity. So that is really important for people to know. But the second thing to say to you as a panel and to the public, it's not just that we're growing in numbers. The best force in the country, the best metropolitan police force in the country is growing, and that should be applauded, and I know that you do. The report that we've had on the Peel inspection says they are good in everything that they do, which we know because that's been what's been said, but they are outstanding in tackling the serious organised crime that we know, we talked about last week. They're not only outstanding in it. HMIC has said, notwithstanding the fact that they are regarded as excellent, they do not stand still, and they are continually looking to improve the way that they tackle these crimes and deliver the service and protect the public and prevent the crimes. So I feel as if the best force in the country should be being enabled to grow even more. It's probably growing as much as it can, but what I would look for, would be lobbying for, would be a commitment from the government this is great for the first 3 years. What we want to see is it year on year, so that forces like Merseyside and Northumbria, who are in a similar position, and some of the other urban forces continue to see this investment over a longer period, so that they can really rebuild to a point that, that the public public had come to rely upon.
This is very much a sort of detailed question, but on what is the 13th page of the report? Well, there's a section on staffing.
What's the paragraph?
Right, it's paragraph 4.4.24, and that follows two other sort of sections about police officer numbers, police staff numbers, and the third one is PCSOs, which I remember raising an issue about PCSOs last year. The previous two sections refer to fairly significant increases, budgeted increases in police officer numbers, police staff numbers, but the PCSO section says that 249 is going to remain unchanged. It also says that about 20% of that number, about 40, well, 47, were vacant back in December. I've always understood and felt it was really useful that one of the, presumably is one of the significant sources of new intakes of police officers is on PCSOs, and I think there are enormous advantages there, because I always assume, without having had a confirmed, that for instance there will always be a drop of people who imagine policing is something and they find out after a year or two. Assuming you've been doing it as a PCSO, you've got a pretty good idea, and you know, et cetera, et cetera. But firstly, presumably, some of those 202 will be going into the police, and that's great. I'm disappointed there isn't an increase, but it might be that even if the 202 actual number were got much closer to the 249 establishment, well, in practical terms, that's a very useful increase. So I'd just like a little bit of explanation. Like, I'm sure I'm not the only member who thinks PCSOs are really useful. Police officers can do everything, but they are, you know, PCSOs are often what people think in the public as being the police, you know, to some extent. They're the people they see a lot. So can I just have some comments on that particular issue? Thank you.
Before I bring you in, Councillor Jennings.
Yeah, it's sort of on the same thing, but just to remember that we're not just talking about money disappearing into a hole, we're talking about employment here. We've got, if 600 officers and one support staff every three, that's 800 people getting work, paid work, full time, which is actually something not to be sniffed at. Thank you.
I think Chief Constable wants to be the best for PCSOs.
Thanks, Councillor. I fully agree with you. Having PCSOs is essential in modern policing. The visible face of policing for a lot of our communities. And they are doing an absolutely outstanding job. We do struggle to maintain numbers, particularly when there's police officer recruitment, because a lot of PCSOs like to become police officers. We're currently recruiting a large number of PCSOs as we speak, excuse me, alongside our police officer recruitment. And there's a fantastic picture, I don't know if you saw it recently on social media, which showed a whole parade ground full of new police officers and PCSOs coming into Merseyside, which actually brought a bit of a tear to even this old cynic's eye. So it was really good to see. with the police officer recruitment and operation uplift from the government, it makes it more difficult to recruit police staff, because we've got to hit certain targets and numbers for police officers, so they become the priority, because that's what we're getting the funding for. We'll get some additional funding for the police staff that come behind it, but nothing like the police officer. So it can be a bit of a perverse incentive at times, because you would, maybe a place where you'd look to put police staff, you would put police officers in the short term because you're getting the money to pay for them. That will work its way through over the next 3 years or so. All I can say to you, like visibility, making sure that we have GEOs in certain places, we won't move away from PCSOs. They are vital to modern policing. They make a real difference at the moment. I think the numbers that we are aiming for is about right, bearing in mind the funding support coming through to recruit new police officers. That may change in 2-3 years' time, but at the moment we need to maintain that balance.
Chair, just a follow-up. For instance, I appreciate for the reasons given it may be difficult to do it within, say, the next 12 months, but would it be the desire, or be it police officer recruitment is, say, government mandated, as a, but to try and get back to the 249 establishments, you know, if like efforts will continue to be made, recognising that lots of well-qualified people are going straight into police officers, whether it's here in Cheshire or whatever. But would it be the desire to get back as close to the 249 establishment as soon as possible?
It is my desire to get back to the 249 establishment.
Yeah.
again, as we discussed, bringing so many people in a short period of time makes it more difficult, but that we are seeking to attain that 249. We're not seeking to keep them vacant. We want the PCSOs back in there.
Great, thank you.
Thank you. Now, unless we have any further comments, queries or questions, we are obliged to provide a report on the proposal. We do have four options, and given the numbers of the panel here today, we do have all four options available to us. And they are, number one, endorse the Precept proposal outright. Number two, endorse the proposal with our own additional recommendations. Number three, reject with recommendations. Or number four, veto. In order to maintain a veto, we must have 8 members of the panel in favour, which I believe would allow, doing quick mental maths in my head, would allow one person to dissent. The difference, of course, between reject and veto is if we veto, the commissioner is obliged to respond. If we reject, the commissioner is not obliged to respond and can proceed as given. So I will be asking for show of hands on each of the four options. So all those in favour of endorsing the Precept proposal, please show. Thank you. All those in favour of endorsing with additional recommendations. All those in favour of rejection. And anyone in favour of vetoing. Very much, 2 seconds. I declare that endorsing the Precept proposal with no additional recommendations is carried. So there we go. We now move on to 2B.
Before we move on, Chair, can I just say I'm grateful to the panel for that. I know the Chief Constable will be, and he will be leaving at this point for agenda, if that's okay, but I just want to express my gratitude to him and his team, and to John in particular, who labours away on this and produces the reports we've had have been excellent. Thank you for all of their work.
Thank you very much. Just very briefly, Chair, if I may just thank you on behalf of my colleagues. We do appreciate that, and I do promise you that we will do all we can to make sure that we continue to improve alongside the increase in staffing. That goes without saying. Thank you all for your support to date so far. It's very much appreciated.
Just wait 1 minute before moving on to allow members of the police staff to leave. Thank you very much. Fantastic. I would now ask members to turn to page 17 of their agenda for item 2B, priority update, support victims, protect vulnerable people and maintain public safety. In this item, our role is to consider the report of the Commissioner in relation to this police priority. Commissioner.
Thank you, Chair. The report presents the activity that I've undertaken to demonstrate my oversight of the priority. The report covers the extensive victims' needs assessment, which my staff conducted 2 years ago, 2017, That led to the redesign of commission services, and Appendix 1 contains comprehensive details of the support that these services have delivered. I'm delighted that Nick Mills is here with me today, because if there's any really detailed questions, I'm hoping you will pick those up to answer. And Nick has led this work from my office. The report also contains examples of events that I've attended, a mix of strategic partnerships and liaison with victims groups, to get a rounded picture and to ensure that current services are working well. My community engagement team also play a vital role in this respect. They attend a number of meetings each week within their local areas and highlight any emerging concerns that they hear about within those areas. They report them to my weekly meetings with the staff, and we try to promptly address any concerns. Of course, as crime becomes more complex, then the need for effective multi-agency partnerships intensifies. And the Safer Mersey Partnership, which has been there for a year now, which I chair, plays a key role in drawing partners together. And it's my ambition for the Protecting Vulnerable People Group, which reports to the Liverpool City Region, that it should report to the City Region through the Safer Mersey Partnership, which gives, because local leading councillors, the leading councillors, the executive members for the subject areas within their local authorities are invited to the Safer Merseyside Partnership, and that board therefore gives local elected members an opportunity to be satisfied with the scrutiny that's going on across Merseyside and that services are coherent and working well. We are going through a review of the structures. The Safer Mersey Partnership also receives reports from the Merseyside Criminal Justice Board, which is an opportunity again for elected members to be briefed on what the criminal justice system is doing with regard to protecting vulnerable people and making sure that the criminal justice system is as efficient as it should be. And my ambition is that the Safer Merseyside Partnership, which used to be called the Community Safety Partnership, that partnership then becomes the main body for feeding up to the regional mayor. So that instead of it at the moment being chief executive led, that it is actually led by elected representatives, which I feel is appropriate for the seriousness of the subject area. That's still a work in progress. It will provide an advisory role and deliver effective links with all of the relevant partnerships. We've also had in recent years the addition of the Organised Crime Partnership. We've got the Violence Reduction Partnership. Sorry, see me a moment. That many partnerships. They will all feed, they're all currently feeding into the Safer Merseyside Partnership. And so long as we establish that good, strong link with the city region and its structures, then the regional mayor will also be able to be confident that things are working as they should be in this field of policy, which isn't strictly at the moment on Merseyside under the regional mayor, but may come at some point in the future. Thank you. Open for questions.
Thank you, Commissioner. Do I have any questions, comments, or queries? Councillor Rowlands and Councillor Sweeney for the moment. Thank you.
Thanks, Commissioner. Two-part question, really. It's noted that 3,590 new cases referrals were received during the reporting period, but 2,429 of those received ongoing support. What are the resolutions or outcomes of those referrals that do not receive the ongoing report?
Did you just say which paragraph that's support. In, sorry? Is it 5-4?
That's a good one.
During the reported period, the services received a total of 3,590 new cases.
5.4. And going on from that, within the statistics, getting these new teeth, across the various support services cited, there are less men than women being referred to self-support. Is there anything specific to target and encourage males to utilise the services more?
I will ask Nick if he would like to add anything. But my understanding would be that 3,590 new case referrals will be picked up by the services to, into which they are referred. In each one of those cases, that vulnerable person or victim of a crime may need ongoing support. It may be that they need that their case is going to court and they need support through that process. It may be that they need support because they are particularly vulnerable and have been particularly damaged by their experience. But there will be others for whom the referral is for a short-term period, and that's why there will be a differential in the numbers. Nick, is that about right?
Yes, Commissioner, that's correct. The services, a whole range of services, deal with a whole range of different types of victims. So you range from the most serious offences, homicide, rape offences, where people need far more ongoing support, and that can extend over months or even years. Some victims of crime only need initial support. That might be to signpost them to another agency or other support method. So it may be a single incident of support which would lead to that victim then dropping off the caseload.
Is that actually a question?
Councillor Sweeney?
Yeah. We noted, Commissioner, that the PAM partnership, the cross-party partnership, has received quite a lot of the grant funding. We're just wondering if, as you talk about these kinds of city-wide or region-wide partnerships, obviously multi-agency partnership working is the most effective, but is there a crossover happening within any of the funding that you're being granted, and if there is any facilities where these partners can meet up and, you know, kind of share best practice? They've applied for quite a lot of the grant funding, but we've just seen from all of those who are applying for money under the service whether there's any collaboration between them.
I think whenever we give any funding out, it is about additionality. We're not giving, you know, we want to see this is for a new scheme here, it's not for an existing one.
Yeah.
And certainly the partnership around the VRU, for example,
yeah,
all that money, that is all additional work. It's on top of the money that we give to the community safety fund funds. So St. Helens, for example, will receive money from the community safety fund,
yeah,
grant, but then the money they receive from the VRU is in addition to what the community safety funding is. Often in terms of the conditions of the grant funding that we receive, it's got to be additional. We're not looking to, if someone can't use it to fund an existing service, so that's what we're trying to do.
Oh, thank you. It's the additional, yeah.
Thank you, Councillor Sweeney. Do we have any further comments, queries or questions on this report? Councillor Jennings?
First of all, I was pretty shocked by the low conviction rate and the rate for rape. That's just, I don't know, that can't be addressed here, but I just thought that was frankly appalling. And I was wondering what can be directed to actually increase that, because those victims will never feel that there's some satisfactory outcome, I would presume. But then also, there seems like quite a wide variety of resources here and different agencies working with different kind of groups of people. Are there any gaps, do you feel? Or is there anything that you've heard is missing from here that needs to be covered?
First of all, that last part, which is the easiest to answer, because we structure the services based around what survey victims are sitting in focus groups with victims. We receive their advice to where the areas, where the spaces are, where the gaps between services. So that's why there was a redesign in 2017 when we conducted that really full-blown victim services, victims needs assessment. We work with the Ministry of Justice through all of this because we have to constantly show to them that the services that we are commissioning firstly are delivering, that they are performing to the contract details that we've specified, and where possible that they do collaborate. So a key successful collaboration is between the rape and sexual assault RASAS. RASA are the rape and sexual assault. So it's two very similarly named, but very different, fiercely independent organisations. But yet, because early days, I made it clear that I didn't want to have two competing services trying to function in the same area. What I wanted to do was to fund a service that was complementary to each other, and that the two services would work together across Merseyside. And to their eternal credit, they both accepted that that was the case, and they work now very harmoniously together to work in the interests of these really vulnerable victims. And I agree, the outcome rates, which we study at every inspection, are woefully low. This is a national problem. It is very complex and relates to the confidence of victims to come forward and then see it through from the first report of the crime right the way through, going through all of the court structures, appearing as a witness and undergoing all of that trauma. That's where it gets more and more difficult to help people through. We work with through these partnership structures, particularly through the Criminal Justice Board, where the Crown Prosecution Service are represented, under which we have subgroups who look at these kinds of crimes. We work particularly hard to make sure that it's a partnership and not one service working against another. I think it's fair to say that we have good partnerships on the other side, but they are beset by the same problems that are national problems. So when the Crown Prosecution Service changed their approach around the seizure of mobile phones and going back over a victim's Facebook and social media comments in order to trawl through and see whether, you know, what the basis of the crime is.